فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So we were speaking about خوارم المروءة. The ulama rahimahumullah, the ulama, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy onto them, they don't refer to a narrator, or they do not see a narrator to have khawarimul muru'ah ala al-itlaqi, unrestrictedly. If he does some khawarimul muru'ah and he doesn't do others, it has to be something that they see from him consistently and continuously. It also has to be something that he's doing on a large scale. Because sometimes you do find some people who are being, have been said about them خوارم المروءة, and they are from what? من أهل العدالة والصدق والديانة. They are from أهل العدالة and الصدق, and people of truthfulness and people of religion, and the عدالة is not removed because of that. If you look at the ulama and the people of knowledge, if you follow and you look at the people of knowledge and their biographies, you realize how much they have been followed up. You find how much they have been followed up. They've been followed up. One narrator, his ins and his outs will be known, because the religion is connected to what he's going to narrate. So they look at his ins and the outs. Once they look at it, if they find that he has come with khawarimul muru'ah marra or marratain, then they say, this maybe is from an angle of min tariq al-khata. Are you with me? But if they see that this man consistently and continuously is always coming with something that's khawarimul muru'ah, then they drop his narration. For example, Al-Imam Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi in his kitab Al-Kifaya, he says, وَالَّذِي عِنْدَنَا فِي هَذَا الْبَابِ رَدُّ خَبَرِ فَاعِلِ الْمُبَاحَاتِ إِلَى الْعَالَمِ وَالْعَمَلُ فِي ذَلِكَ بِمَا يَقْوَى فِي نَفْسِهِ فَإِنْ غَلَبَ عَلَى ظَنِّهِ مِنْ أَفْعَالِ مُرْتَكِبِ الْمُبَاحِ الْمُسْقِطُ لِلْمُرُوءَةِ أَنَّهُ مَطْبُوعٌ عَلَى فِعْلِ ذَلِكَ وَالتَّسَاهُلِ بِهِ مَعَ كَوْنِ مِمَّنْ لَا يَحْمِلُ نَفْسَهُ عَلَى الْكَذِبِ فِي خَبَرِهِ وَشَهَادَتِهِ بَلْ يَرَى إِعْظَامَ ذَلِكَ وَتَحْرِيمَهُ والتنزه عنه وقوبل خبره وإن ضعفت هذه الحال في نفس العالم واتهم عندنا وجب عليه ترك العمل بخبره ورد شهادته. So what is it that the scholars rahimahumullah jami'an that Khatib al-Baghdadi is referring to is that the scholars, they would look at تتبع من وقع فيه من الرواة. They wouldn't just look at one narrator. They would see if this is a common trait that is present by other narrators. So is he alone in doing this? They will look at it. They'll also look at what? They'll also look at the individual. Is it once or twice that it occurred from him? They'll look at that, they'll observe that. The fifth shart that's looked at is Allah yakuna mughaffalan. The fifth and last condition for adala is what? Allah yakuna mughaffalan. That the narrator is not mughaffal, he's not heedless. يقبل التلقين. What does it mughaffal mean? Is heedless. That he doesn't accept talqeen. What does talqeen mean? Talqeen means that whenever somebody narrates a hadith to him, and somebody gives him a hadith, he will know if it's his narration or not, and he will say, no, I didn't ever narrate this hadith, this has nothing to do with my hadith. He realizes that he's alert. But if he accepts any narrations that are thrown at him and he said, oh, this is some of the narrations that you've narrated, and he goes, na'am, these are my narrations, then they say, يَقْبَلُ التَّلْقِينَ. He accepts dictation. He accepts dictation. So they don't take his narrations. They don't take dictation. ولذلك الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير, as is in the kitab جرح والتعديل by Ibn Abi Hatim, and also in the kitab الكفاية, that he said, الغفلة التي ترد بها حديث الرجل الرضا الذي لا يعرف بكذب هو أن يكون في كتاب غلط فيقال له في ذلك فيترك ما في كتابه ويحدث بما قالوا أو بغيره في كتابه بقولهم لا يعقل فرق ما بين ذلك أو يصحف تصحيفا فاحشا فيقلب المعنى لا يعقل ذلك فيكف عنه وكذلك من لقنا فتلقن التلقين يرد حديثه الذي لقن فيه وأخذ عنه ما أتقن حفظه إذا علم أن ذلك التلقين حادث في حفظه لا يعرف به قديما فأما من عرف به قديما في جميع حديثه فلا يقبل حديثه ولا يؤمن أن يكون ما حفظ مما لقن. حميدي عبد الله بن زبير mentions that the heedlessness in which a person's narration is rejected is when he's not known to lie, he's not a liar. But he's a person who somebody can come and say to him, oh, what you've written in your book here is wrong. You wrote a mistake in your book. And then he will accept that. He will say, oh, yeah, you're right, it is wrong. And then he would accept what anybody tells him regarding his own writing. Then his narrations are rejected and they're left. Also, if he does mistakes between, for example, he doesn't know the difference between this and this. They ask him, what's the difference between this and this? And he doesn't know it. Or he writes it wrong. And sometimes when you write something wrong, you should, oh, I wrote something wrong. You should automatically know, even if you don't go back to the original. Because of the fact that you are a person who's well aware of what could be said and what can't be said. If he doesn't know any of that, or if somebody comes up to him and says to him, you told, these narrations are yours. You know, and he goes, na'am. And he takes it quickly. But he's not known to lie, but he thinks he did. He's ghafil, he's heedless. He's unaware. And the fact that he's unaware is a problem. The ilm al-hadith, the person has to be aware from the minute they take it to the minute they pass it on. They have to. So his narrations are not accepted. وَلِذَلِكَ that was when he tested Yahya ibn Ma'in was testing Abu Lu'ayn Fadl ibn Dukayn. And Ahmad ibn Hanbal was with him. He was trying to see that if Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn was what? Ghafil, heedless. وَيَقْبَلُ التَّلْقِينَ And he would accept dictation. If any narration can be told him, and he would accept it. So what he did was he brought a couple of narrations to him, and he brought five narrations that were his and five that weren't his. So he placed between the two narrations, he placed one narration that wasn't his. So he'd say one narration, it's Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn's narration. Abu Nu'aym will say, that's my narration. Then he would tell him a narration that's not his. And then he'll tell him a narration that's his, a narration that's not his, a narration that's his, a narration that's not his, and then a narration that's his. He kept doing that. So Abu Nu'aym, first time he says it's mine. Then he does it again. And he says, this is not mine. And he asked him another narration, he says, yes, this is mine. And then after that, he realized, Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn realized Yahya ibn Ma'in is up to something. Because you could ask me once or twice, maybe, is this your narration? But you keep asking me many narrations that are not mine. But you're up to something. So he felt that it was fishy what Yahya ibn Ma'in was doing. And Yahya ibn Ma'in, what was he doing? He was trying to check, أَيَقْبَلُ التَّلْقِينَ Does he accept dictation? Would he accept if somebody dictates to him? So Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn became very angry. He took his leg out and kicked Yahya ibn Ma'in off the stool, on the chest. He kicked him with his leg. And before that, he looked at Ahmad ibn Hanbal and he said, you're a noble, honorable man, Ahmad. You're a man who wouldn't come up with this stuff. You wouldn't do something like this. And he kicked Yahya off the chair. Yahya stumbled on the floor. He got up. And then him and Ahmad went together. And then Ahmad said to Yahya, did I not tell you this man is a thiqa, he's a jabal, he's a mountain, he's like this. He won't move. Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn doesn't move from his position. Yahya ibn Ma'in responded by saying, this journey of me coming to Abdul Razak ibn Hammam al-San'ani, because he visited before Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, who did they meet? Abdul Razak. Yahya and Ahmad and Yahya both went up to Abdul Razak. So he said to him, my journey to Abdul Razak and that kicking of Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, I prefer the kicking of Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn. It was worth more to me than the journey to Abu Abdul Razak ibn Hammam al-San'ani. What does he mean by that? He means, I now know when somebody asks me about Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn and I come across his narrations, I know who I'm dealing with. I know who I am dealing with. So what was he checking him from? He was trying to see if he's going to accept any talqeen, if he's going to accept dictatorship. So what became clear to him was what? That Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn was not a person who was mughaffalan, a person who was heedless. He was not. So his narrations, he got accepted. The next condition is what? The third condition. When I say the third condition, what do I mean? The third condition of authentic hadith, right? Now we finished the five conditions of adala. Now I'm going back to the third condition for what? صحيح لغيري. صحيح لذاتي, sorry. What was the first condition? أيكولا متصل السند. The second one is what? أيكولا أيكولا عدلا. And the narrator is reliable, has high integrity. And now we're going to go into the third condition, which is? The third condition, which is أن يكون رواته ضابطين. أن يكون رواته ضابطين. أن يكون رواته ضابطين. That the narrators who are narrating it are, they have ضبط. ضبط means what? What does it mean? It means, first of all, let's categorize the ضبط into how many types? Two. The first one is, the first one is called ضبط الصدر. It's called ضبط الصدر. And it is precision by memory. The person's precision here is by memorization. They've got it off heart. And the second one is called, it's called ضبط الكتابة. This one is precision by what? Writing. ولذلك يحيى بن معين said الثبت ثبتاني. ثبت here and ضبط are both what? They both mean the same. He said there are two. يحيى بن معين said. He said ثبت الصدر and ثبت كتاب. ثبت الصدر and ثبت كتاب. وأبو صالح كاتب الليث ثبت كتاب. يحيى بن معين said. And as for Abu Salih, he is a person who is precise and he has precision based on what? Based on writing. Based on what? Based on writing. So the first one is called? It's called ضبط الصدر. What does it mean? It means أن يكون الراوي قد حفظ مروياته في صدره. Is that he memorized his narrations from the top of his head. وأتقن حفظا لها. أما وأتقن حفظه لها. And the memorization of it, he has it in his head strong. واستمر هذا الضبط. And this ضبط, it carried on معه إلى حينما يحدث بهذا الحديث من حفظه فيؤديه إلى غيره. As I said before, from the time he heard it until the time he narrates it, he has to have it with him. ولذلك the times of the narrations are three types, right? From what we've taken. There's one called what? وقت التحمل. Okay? And there's what? ووقت الأداء. And the time of conveying, right? And there's a time in between that. Which is sometimes the exam when it comes, you get tested. They're testing you. Ulama al-Hadith will test you. They will test you in between what? وقت التحمل and وقت الأداء. The person, the minute he takes it, to the minute he conveys it, all of that time he has to have what? Precision of it. And the time which is in between it, والوقت الذي بينهما. He has to have it with him. The second one which is called ضبط الكتاب is that أن يكون الكتاب محفوظا لدى الراوي. The book in which he wrote this hadith in has to be preserved with him. Preservation is important. وأن يكون مقابلا مصححا مراجعا على أصله. The book has to be, first of all, preserved, number one. Number two, it has to be مقابلاً. He has to have compared it to the original copy. He had to have corrected the mistakes or whatever's in there. He also has to, مثلاً, he has to revise it regularly. Are you with me? So revise it and go over it and check it, if it's preserved, if it's intact. You can't just copy it and put it in a place and shelf and forget about it. Has to consistently be looking over it. Are you with me? Very good. It also has to be what? If he's comparing it to مثلاً, to other people who memorized it, he has to make sure he checked it, compared to their memorization and he verified. He also has to be able to protect this book from any type of person playing with it or tampering with it. It should be protected from that. These are all what? These are all important points that have to be. And if he does choose to give it to somebody, if they bring it back and they add an extra dot, because he's got precision in his writing, and he's got precision in everything, if they add a dot somewhere, a dot, because it's dots that can change the difference between Abbas and Ayash. What's the difference? It's just dots. Sahih? And they're two different names. He knows the difference. He knows his writing. He knows what was written there. Because he's got precision in what? He's got precision in what? He's got precision in writing. Very good. So if he gives his book and he allows somebody to borrow it, they bring it back, if he checks it and he realizes they put something in there, he needs to know, okay, what they put in and what was originally his. He needs to know the difference between the two. This is the tamiz that's needed from him. The example of Sufyan ibn Waqi', the man by the name of Sufyan ibn Waqi'. He was a person who was not aware. If anybody wrote in his book, he would. So he didn't have Tabtul Kitab. He didn't have that. Very good. So if a person has Dabtul Kitab, what does he have? He has Dabtul Kitab. Is he allowed to narrate from Dabtul Sadr? Is he allowed to narrate from his memory? No, it won't be accepted. If he's Dabt, it's from his book. The only time when he wants to narrate, he has to narrate from his book. Are you with me? He has to narrate from his book. There are some people who have both. Allah has given them both, subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, his dabtuhu is what? Dabtu sadrin. And he's also got dabtu kitabin. He's got both. His kitab is sahihun muqabal. And he also memorized it from the top of his head. This individual is allowed for him whenever he wants to go to his book and whenever he wants to use his memory. No problem. Which one is better, both of them? The one who has both. The one who has is both is better. But the one who has both, which one is better for him? To do it by memory or to do it from his book? The ulama, they say, it's better for him, وَإِنْ كَانَ تَحَدِيثُ مِنْ كِتَابِهِ أَوْ لَا, for him to narrate it from his book is more befitting. The reason is because لِأَنَّ الْحِفْظَ يَخُونُ, your memory can deceive you. وَالْكِتَابَ أَبْعَدُ عَنِ الْخَطَأِ وَالنِّسْيَانِ, and the what? The kitab, the book, is furthest from what? Mistakes and shortcomings. The fourth condition for a hadith to be authentic is what? أَلَّا يَكُونَ شَاذًا, that it can't be shad. It can't be what? It can't be shad. What does shad mean? Shad means مَا رَوَاهُ ثِقَةٌ مُخَالِفًا لِمَنْ هُوَ أَوْثَقُ مِنْهُ. It's when a reliable person, this person is reliable, okay? What's the term thiqa used for again? Hayya, Ahmedak, hayya. The word thiqa is used. What did the ulama mean by thiqa? Allahu Akbar. Is when the person's adl is on point and their precision, their dabt is on point. They use the third term, what? Thiqa. Are you there? That's what they mean. Thiqa means adala is in place and what? And Tabt is also intact. So he's got Adl, all the 5 points that we mentioned from Adala. And he also has with him, he also has the Tabt with him. His precision is on point. That individual, he opposes Man huwa awthaqu minhu, somebody who is higher than him, either in memory, okay? Or they're higher than him in what? Or مُخَالِفًا جَمَاعَةَ الثِّقَاتِ, or they're larger than him in number. These people are more than him in number. he might be higher than them individually. Okay, it's possible. Individually he might be. But because they're all thiqat, are you there, sisters and brothers? They're all thiqat, and he's all by himself. He is opposing them in a narration. This hadith is called what? His narration, the one who opposed, what's it called? Yeah, the one who's by himself, his narration is called shadh. What's the one on the other side called? Like the other ones. It's called mahfuz. Are you there? If that narrator loses thiqah, he's not thiqah, he's da'if, he's weak. And he opposes the thiqat. What's it called? What's the narration called? Munkar. Are you there? And theirs is called? Ma'ruf. So the difference between shad and munkar is what? The individual, if he's thiqa or if he's da'if. That's the farq. Are you with me? So if the one who opposed is, when we say opposition, the opposition are one of two. He's thiqa. He opposes them one of two. Either he opposes them and the individual he's opposing, him, he's opposing only one person, but this person's thiqanness is higher than his. How is he higher than in terms of thiqa? In terms of memory. He's more precise than him. Okay, adal is not looked at in this issue. What's looked at is the dabt. He's greater than him in dabt. So his thiqanness is higher. So the scholars, they say, مُخَالَفَةُ الثِّقَةِ لِمَنْ هُوَ أَوْثَقُ مِنْهُ. A thiqa opposed one who is greater than him. Are you with me? Good. Now we have a thiqa opposing other thiqat who are more than him in number. This is again another form of shadh. Why is it shadh? Because the one who is opposing is always a thiqa in both scenarios. But if that person who is opposing the thiqat is not thiqa, he's da'if, he's weak. His memory is weak. He's no memory, he's weak at his memory. Are you there? What happens in this situation? He's not called shadh. This is not called shadh. It's called what? Munkar. Their one is called what? Ma'ruf. But if he's thiqa, their one is called what? Mahfuz, and then his one is called shad. We'll come to the issue of munkar and ma'ruf and shad and mahfuz. We'll come to that inshallah ta'ala. So what did we say shad is? Ma'rawahu thiqa. Is what a person who's thiqa narrates. Mukhalifan man huwa awthaqu minhu. أو مخالفا جماعة الثقات, or he opposes a amount who are larger than him in number. ومن قائل أن some who say ما رواه المقبول مخالفا لمن هو أولى منه بالقبول. Some say that. Are you with me? All of these ta'arif are mentioned, and then la mushahata fi istilah, as we say. Now I want to ask you guys a question. Is shad da'if then? Is it min aqsam al-da'if? Is it from the types of hadith which we'll say is weak? Yeah? Yeah? Question now is, why do we find that Imam al-Bukhari narrate a hadith that are shadh in his sahih? Second question, do you find the abrogated ahadiths, are they weak? Yeah? Yeah? Hadith which is abrogated, is it weak? Imran said, no, it's not weak, but it's not implemented. Jameel, that's very good. Are you there? Shaykhuna, Shaykh Muhammad Ali Adim in Ethiopia, in the Sharh of Sahih Muslim, he pushes the opinion that Shad is not weak. وَلَيْسَتْ مِنْ أَقْسَامِ الضَّعِيفِ. And he believes, he pushes, that the shad is what? Yeah? It's just like the abrogated one, huh? Are you with me? And he said it's also like the hadith, which is what? Mukhtalaful hadith. The hadith which is? The Mukhtalaful hadith, which cannot be re... We can't, there's no which would... Jama'ah, we're struggling to reconcile between this hadith. What do? Adabul amal. There's no way to implement it. We don't weaken it. So he said the hadith which is shadh is just adabul amal bihi. There's no implementation that will be done on it. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? But he says, laysat min aqsam al-da'if. It's not from the category of the weak narrations or that which is mardood, rejected. Ma ra'yukum? What do you guys think? Hey, Muhammad. Muhaddithin believe that statement that Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopia and others might push is a discussion that the Usuliyin open. Are you with me? Amma fi lada ahl al-hadith, according to the people of hadith, hadith shadh which is da'if. Na'am. Like in ulama al-hadith, they need from it the issue of da'af, or is it not da'if? Now what I would say is that this khilaf is called khilaf al-tanawwu'. It's khilaf lafzi. Because whether you make it da'if or not, both of you are not going to implement it. No problem. Are you with me? One wants to refer to it as da'if, and the other one wants to refer to it as sahih, but they are both agreeing there's no amal on it. Are you with me? No, not one of them are saying that we implement the shad. Are you with me? So the khilaf here is what? Khilaf lafzi. It's khilaf in terms of wording. Application-wise, theory, they're different. But application-wise, both of them, in the waqi' that we're living in, they're going to be doing the same thing. There's no different path that they're going to take. But on Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim in Ethiopia's side, he is in a way pushing for the issue of what? He's pushing for what? That the ulama before, they would not consider the shad to be a qism al-aqsam al-hadith al-mardood. Because they would bring that in their sahih. Are you with me? They would bring it in their books of hadith. And they would use it in their books. Because shad is only what? It's seen later. All the other conditions are there. Mukhalafa, opposition, can be found when a person does all the jam'ah of the hadith, right? So this is why he pushes it, alayhi rahmat. And he has a very nice research on it, Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi. I think he mentions it in his Qurrat Uyun al-Muhtaj, fi sharh al-muqaddimah Muslim ibn al-Hajjaj, the muqaddimah. He has a sharh on it. You find it in there. He's got a nice couple of good pages that he writes about it. And there's fawa'id, beautiful fawa'id out of it. That if you go back to, inshallah ta'ala, you can extract from it. And it's good to look into it, inshallah ta'ala, make it a bit of your research. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to go more into the issue of shad when the time comes, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. And I think this issue of shad, inshallah ta'ala, I really think a good research should be done about it. Shad, a research, a proper, thorough discussion should be done regarding the hadith which is shad. And if somebody actually afarad lahu bitta'lif, specifically open a book of authorship for that, wallahi lakana hasanan, it would be something very good. Last but not least, the last condition is what? An yakuna salima min al-illah. The fifth condition for the hadith to be sahih is أن يكون سالما من العلة, that the hadith is safe from what? From defect. So what does it mean, كون الحديث سالما من العلة? What does it actually mean that the hadith is safe from defect? What does it mean? It means أن يكون الحديث سالما من أي نوع من أنواع الخطأ الواقع به. That it's basically safe from any form of defect there is. Whether that mistake comes from the thiqat, the reliable ones, min ghayri qasdin, without any intention. Sometimes a thiqa, thabt, precise, grounded individual might do a mistake. That mistake is al-qilla. Are you with me? Al-qadih fi al-riwayah. It really slices through the narration. It really damages the narration. So this is what it means. How is it that this mistake can be seen? Because remember, we just talked about some mistakes. We just talked about ittisal al-sanad. That's a mistake. Are we, that's a defect. That's a illah. When we say illah here, it is specifically illah which is ghamidah, khafi. It's not an illah which eyes can see easily. Are we all together? Because this type of illah only would, this illah means this defect would only be known when the person has اكتشاف هذا الخطأ, this coming to the conclusion of this mistake and getting to the bottom of it, it requires and it needs from you معارضة روايات الثقات بعضهم ببعض وبالنظر في اختلاف في الرواية. Looking at the different types of narrations there are, there has to be opposition of the narrators who are reliable with those who are not reliable, and those who are other reliable ones. And why are they opposing? And who has more thiqat? Who is higher in that? All of that requires diqqatun nadar. It requires. Also, a person who sat with a sheikh every day but missed two or three classes, and he wasn't there that day, and he's a mudallis, and he narrated the hadith with tadlis from a sheikh that he normally takes from, overwhelming narrations. How would you know he was missing from that gathering for those 3-4 days which he narrated with that word an'ana? This is what? Is a illa which is khafi, a hidden defect. This is a hidden. These types of khata, these kind of mistakes, لا يطلع عليه غالبا. Majority of the time, no one is able to get, be alert on that. And no one is able to see that إلا أئمة الجهابذة النقاد, the elite, prominent scholars like شعبة بن الحجاج, يحيى بن سعيد القطان, أحمد بن حنبل, عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, الإمام البخاري, مسلم, أبي داود, الترمذي, النسائي, ابن عدي, دار قطني, وأمثالهم من الأئمة النقاد. And the likes of these أئمة, they are the ones who will look into the narration, they are the ones who would observe it, and they are the ones who will get to the bottom of it. ولذلك شعبة بن الحجاج إمام جبل أشم, solid, powerful mountain, can't be moved easily. He can't. يحيى بن سعيد القطان is the same. رحمه الله رحمة الواسعة. الإمام أحمد رحمه الله. الإمام يحيى بن معين. عبد الرحمن بن مهدي. الإمام البخاري المسلم and أبي داود. الإمام الترمذي رحمه الله. الإمام الترمذي. Also الإمام الدارقطني رحمه الله. Also ابن عدي رحمه الله. These علماء وأمثالهم من الأئمة, and the likes of these which we haven't mentioned, these are referred to as, and they are called أئمة الجهابذة النقاد. They are each individually جهبذ, meaning they are elite scholars. They are elite scholars. And this chapter, which is Kaunul Hadithi Salima min al-illah, that the hadith has to be safe from defect, is what? Min adaqi mabahith al-hadith. This is the actual, the most detailed, the most serious, and the most important chapter in ilm al-hadith. It's the most detailed one. It is the most deepest one. You put your finger in, you have to put your whole hand in there. Oh no, my whole leg, you go in. It's deep, it's not just surface level. Okay? And it's the most hidden. You see the narration from the apparent, but it's weak. ولذلك الشيخ مقبل بن هادي الوادع عليه رحمة الله, he wrote a kitab called what? أحاديث معلة ظاهرها الصحة. أحاديث معلة. These أحاديث are defected. ظاهرها الصحة. But when you look at it from the apparent, they're all صحيح. All that which we mentioned, اتصال السند, everything is there. Are you there, brothers? ظاهرها الصحة. Ahadith mu'alla, ظاهرها الصحة. It's mu'alla, the hadith is defected. But really, the reality of it is that it's weak. It's not. But it looks sahih to you from the apparent. So if a person wants to know a hadith, if it's defected, and it's got a defect in it, he can never be without going back to the who? The Aimatul Jahabidat al-Nuqat. Lazimahu. It is obligatory on him. And yarja'a ila Aimatul Nuqat al-Jahabidat. He has to go back to the ulama. Like those which we mentioned. And that he doesn't in any way, form or shape. In any way, form or shape, he does not what? That he doesn't take a hadith min ghayri ahlihi, that he doesn't take it from its people. Okay? Al-Mukhtasina bihi. Because we know, فَلِكُلِّ عِلْمٍ رِجَالٌ. Every science has its people, has its men, has its people who stand up for it. وَالْمُوَفِّقُ. The one who Allah gives ability, the one who has ability, the one who has an ability for something, is the one Allah gave it to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has given him the ability. وَالْمُوَفَّقُ مَنْ وَفَّقَهُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. This issue, inshaAllah ta'ala, is where we're going to be, idhnillahi kareem. We'll stop this point, inshaAllah ta'ala. We'll stop here. We'll go to the other points of the Shaykh rahimahullah. All we did today is we took the sharah of Khabarul Ahad bi naqli adlin tam al-dabti muttasil al-sanadi ghayra mu'allalin wala shadhin huwa al-sahihu lidatihi. That's all we took. Inshallah ta'ala, we will stop there for today, because Ibn Hajar rahimahullah goes into something else, which is وتفاوت رتبه بتفاوت هذه الأوصاف. So we'll salah go into that bi'idhnillahi al-kareem in more details. Anything which I have said that was wrong, incorrect, shortcomings or faults that might have come from me, is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.